How's everybody? Not good enough. I realize it's Monday morning. One more time. How's everybody? Okay. Welcome to the 2024 Aviation Forum. It's great to be back together again in Las Vegas. Now, here you go. One, two, three. Viva Las Vegas! I realize this is a bunch of engineers, but come on. By the way, make sure you stay hydrated while you're running around out here. It's great and it's very energizing to welcome everyone here for this forum. Convening the community is the most important role for AIAA. We know how important it is for our members to hear the progress, share the ideas, and address the technical challenges across aviation, and we take that responsibility very seriously, and we are so glad you are here. Our forum theme is anticipating the future as we move from the vision through velocity, transitioning technology into reality. AIAA is maintaining a sharp focus on the future of aeronautics, which is why it is one of the three AIAA domains, along with aerospace research and development and space. Progressing toward the future means having a vision, building the tools and systems, and safely operating the products that we create. Collectively, we have a vision and we have the expertise and the desire. As an industry, we will accelerate towards that future by rapidly and efficiently bridging the gap between visionary concepts and tangible reality. The aviation industry is embracing opportunities in the near term that will contribute to its enduring legacy of benefiting society and reshaping everyday life as we know it. In the next 5 to 10 years, many new capabilities will be introduced. The next generation will experience flight in ways we can only imagine today. This week, the Aviation Forum is the epicenter for the researchers, engineers, and pioneers who are driving innovation into aviation. We have built this week's program for you to hear how our community is, number one, confronting the global challenges, shifting the transportation paradigm, accelerating the electrified aircraft and sustainability, and exploring the next generation technologies. We will hear from the thought leaders and innovators about new capabilities on their horizon that will take us further, faster, safer, and cleaner. We will also hear from the scores of researchers, engineers, and industry leaders on their progress in their labs, in their wind tunnels, and on their tarmacs. AIAA has put a strategic focus on increasing the diversity of our industry. In planning this week's program, we have strived to showcase this diversity. You'll see that some sessions do a better job of this than others. Our overall goal is to ensure that we have the speakers that represent the depth and the breadth of this industry, bringing the best talent from across the industry. We also want to welcome everyone attending the Electric Aircraft Technology Symposium. That is co-sponsored with IEEE and the Sustainable Aviation and Research and Engineering Society. You will notice that we're hosting another signature AIAA event this week. Tomorrow, we will welcome the space community to Caesars Forum for Ascend, where we will accelerate building humanity's off-world future. Your registration is an all-access ticket to all of the sessions of your choice in the Aviation Forum as well as the Ascend program. We have planned some sessions that will appeal to everyone, and they are listed on pages 8 and 9 in the program. This is going to be a very unique week and a very exciting week. We could not do this without the generous support of our sponsors. Please join me in thanking our premier sponsor, Lockheed Martin, our top sponsors, the Boeing Company, Northrop Grumman, the Aerospace Corporation, United Launch Alliance, RTX, and Aerojet Rocketdyne. We thank all of the companies listed here as sponsors. Let's say thank you. This week's aviation program features over 1,100 research papers presented throughout the week. Thank you to the authors for working so hard on all of your technical work and preparing the manuscripts. The technical program is the one key feature that sets AIAA apart from all other events in the industry. At an AIAA forum, we deliver the deeper look at current research and technologies geared to solve the specific problems. Our incredible guiding coalition and technical program committee have volunteered countless hours to bring these speakers and this technical research together. They are demonstrating the true meaning of the AIAA vision to shape the future with this program. You will have the chance to meet many of these key volunteers throughout the week. They were joined by a large group of dedicated volunteers. All of their names are listed in the program, and please say thank you to them when you see them around this week. Let's say thank you to all the people that do the hard work to help plan the program. Now, I'd also like to welcome our diversity scholars today. They're sitting over here, or at least it looks like most of them are. These 24 young people are here to network and learn and gather information to inform their future career decisions. This program hosts underrepresented minority university students at AIAA forums who have an interest in or are pursuing a degree in aerospace. Two-thirds of our group here are first-generation college students, and for the first time, they are all women. So welcome the diversity scholars. We are especially grateful to the Boeing Company and to Blue Origins Club for the Future for their support of the Diversity Scholar Program. Welcome to everyone. Now for the awards presentation. While the world is celebrating athletic excellence at the Olympics in Paris, we are celebrating the excellence of AIAA members by presenting awards each morning. Yes, we would like to think of AIAA as the Olympics for aerospace. I'd like to invite Martiqua Post, director of the AIAA Aerospace Sciences Group, to the stage to present today's two awards. Welcome, Martiqua. It is my pleasure to begin with the 2024 AIAA Fluid Dynamics Award. This award is presented for outstanding contributions to the understanding of the behavior of liquids and gases in motion as related to need in aeronautics and astronautics. The 2024 AIAA Fluid Dynamics Award is presented to Mark Glauser, Emeritus and Research Professor, Department of Mechanical and Aerospace Engineering, Syracuse University. The award citation reads, "For seminal contributions on the innovative use of multi-point low-dimensional methods for understanding and control of turbulent flows." Congratulations, Mark. Next, the 2024 AIAA Ground Testing Award recognizes outstanding achievement in the development of effective utilization of technology, procedures, facilities, or modeling techniques for flight simulation, space simulation, propulsion testing, aerodynamic testing, or other ground testing associated with aeronautics and astronautics. The 2024 Ground Testing Award is presented to Marvin Sellers, Subject Matter Expert, 716th Test Squadron, Axient Incorporated. The award citation reads, "In recognition of decades of tremendous contributions to the national ground test and evaluation community, most particularly in the advancement of pressure-sensitive paint techniques." Congratulations, Marvin. Great to have the awards. And yes, this is the Olympics of aerospace. Intro now for the plenary. Let's welcome our speakers for this morning's fireside chat. The intent of the chat between our speakers is to take a strategic perspective of aviation in particular, and aerospace in general, from about the 50,000 foot level. Then they will touch on the headline strategic issues that confront our industry and AIAA moving forward. Our speakers are Dan Hastings, our AIAA President, and Dr. Russell Boyce, our AIAA Aeronautics Domain Lead. Dan Hastings just began his role as the AIAA president in May. He is an AIAA fellow and became an AIAA honorary fellow in 2021. Dan has been on the faculty at MIT in aeronautics and astronautics since 1985. His research specializations include synergistic interactions between space systems and the space environment, space propulsion, space policy, and space systems engineering. Among his external appointments, he has served as the chief scientist for the U.S. Air Force in the late 1990s, where he led studies of Air Force investments in space. He also was the chair of the Air Force Scientific Advisory Board afterward. He has served on the NASA Advisory Council and on numerous committees of the National Academies of Sciences, Engineering, and Medicine. He has been on the Board of Trustees for the Aerospace Corporation for over 18 years. Joining Dan will be Russell Boyce, who serves as our AIAA Aeronautics Domain Lead, also an AIAA Fellow. Russell is a seasoned leader and strategic advisor with over 35 years of experience across disruptive technologies. This included 25 years in hypersonic aerothermodynamics and propulsion research, with several years as the Defense Science and Technology Organization Chair for Hypersonics at the University of Queensland. In that role, he led the International Scram Space Scramjet Flight Experiment Program, among many other activities. For the past decade, Russell has switched fields to build a space mission program at the University of New South Wales in Canberra in the role of Chair for Intelligent Space Systems. With his team, he developed and flew five Art of the Possible satellites for Australian Defence, including the M2 formation flying CubeSat with onboard optical and RF sensors and onboard AI, and led the founding of Skycraft, one of three successful commercial spin-offs from his team. Russell has chaired the Australian Academy of Sciences National Committee for Space and Radio Science for several years, helped establish the Australian Space Agency, and has played a major role in the growth of Australia's young space sector. Today, he is pursuing multiple interests, building leadership and technology capacity, building programs for developing nations as ambassador for Indo-Pac and the Milo Space Institute, teaching strategic thinking into the senior executive education program at the Global Top 5 Business School, INSEAD, and publishing the monthly podcast, Leadership in a Disruptive World. Please join me in welcoming Dan and Russell to the stage. Go get them.
So, Russ, we're going to have a conversation. So I have a number of questions to ask you. And then after a while, the audience will have the opportunity to ask some questions. So we'll get to issues of strategic direction soon. But first, I note there's quite some overlap between your hypersonics background and your space activities. Can you map that out for us? Give the audience your own insight into the synergy that's implicit in the word aerospace?
Dan, thanks for that question. You're right, there's a lot of synergy. There's a lot of synergy between the air and the space part of the word aerospace. And in my own career, I've been fortunate to play in both areas. What has that meant for me? So as Dan Dumbacker mentioned, 25 years of hypersonics. For me, hypersonics is the interaction between high-speed objects and their environment. And I'm actually a physicist, I'm not an engineer, so I took a very physics-based approach to that. And then along came the opportunity to build a space segment of my career. The motivation for that, actually there's potentially a gentleman in the audience somewhere, Marie Bajar, heard him give a keynote in Australia back in 2013. And he had just written the Continuing Kepler's Quest. It was the US Air Force standards for astrodynamics.
Right.
And he pointed out that there is a strong need for understanding the interaction between high-speed objects and their environment, but in this case, much, much higher altitude and lower density.
Right.
So for me, it was just a natural leap from hypersonic air-breathing propulsion and aerodynamics in the atmosphere to satellites and how they interact with the thermosphere and the ionosphere in orbit. Take that a little bit further, that the same methodology of understanding that interaction applied in hypersonics. For me, it was intensive computational fluid dynamics simulations, experimental work in hypersonic shock tunnels, and flight experiments. Translate that over to space, it's the same deal, except the simulations become rarefied gas, direct simulation Monte Carlo, and particle and cell methods,
right,
because we have an ionosphere up there with charged particles, and we have charged spacecraft.
Right.
Need to validate with experiments, and we did some of that, but the real validation comes in doing flight experiments, which means space missions, satellites for the purpose of doing some gnarly things in orbit. I'll wind up this answer in just a moment, but we learnt along the way by flying multiple spacecraft at the same time in formation just how strong the effects of the atmosphere in low Earth orbit are, and the effects of non-uniform gravitational fields,
right,
radiation pressure and so on. If you just got one spacecraft that you're worrying about, and it moves around a little bit in orbit, well, you don't really notice because you get the track the next day from the space catalog and away you go again. If you've got two in orbit and you're controlling them with low Earth orbit aerodynamics, and you're trying to move them up close to each other, move them back again, pass them, etc., you really get to see the strong effects of that interaction between the high-speed object and its environment.
Right. So that's fascinating. So we've done some of the same things. You know, I did some initial work in hypersonics, but then I moved out to geosynchronous orbit.
Right.
Much further out than you were working. So next question. Let's talk strategy. The approach by AIAA has been to establish domains for aeronautics, space, and R&D. That's been underway for 3 years now. For those not familiar with the domains, tell us about them and about their strategic intent.
Thanks, Dan. To understand the domain approach, let's step back a few decades. What was going on in the world of aerospace a few decades ago? There was a strong need to develop systems that worked, a strong need to understand the physics and the engineering. And so AIAA was developing at a time where technology disciplines were, well, they still are very important, but it was extremely important at that stage to focus on those disciplines. And so the way AIAA has evolved as an organization and as a community is very strongly focused on what I'll call technology stovepipes. And there's an effort to link those stovepipes with integration efforts. Mm. But by and large, the work that gets done by the membership in the context of AIAA, until recently, it had been largely focused on those technical areas. Mm. But as Dan Dumbacker would say, and I think has on many an occasion, things have progressed since then. A lot of those technical disciplines have been bedded down. There are still new ones evolving, but by and large, they've been bedded down. It's important now to take a more systems approach and system of systems. And in fact, a complex system of systems where we've got both the space layer and the air and other modes, maritime, land, and so on, and digital, cyber, these different domains, different systems of activity, the way they link and intertwine, we have to start understanding that. And we have to start understanding where not just the aerospace stakeholder mm-hmm. fits in that picture, but the non-aerospace stakeholder. Mm-hmm. That non-aerospace stakeholder could be the investor, could be the regulator, the legislator, the end user, the general public. How does that all fit together in a big picture? So the domain approach was developed to start to build that thinking at a strategic level into the way AIAA builds its programs and designs the products and the offerings that it offers to the community. So we have three domains. There's the space domain, mm-hmm. the aeronautics domain or aviation, and the research and development domain. And the way you can think about those, imagine that the R&D domain is the transformational emerging technologies which are pushing on mission applications. The space and the aeronautics domain are pulling from that emerging R&D and applying them to the missions and then extending out across that full value chain of stakeholders.
Mm. Well, but the way you described it, it sounds like all these domains have to talk to each other.
And indeed we do. So there's a domain lead for each. That's one way in which we talk, as in personal talking. So the three domain leads, myself, Brent Sherwood, who is the domain lead for space, and Greg Zacharias, who's the domain lead for aerospace research and development. Incidentally, tomorrow morning, 9:30, the three of us will be speaking in a meta session in the Ascend part of the conference. You're all welcome to come if you can fit into the room, talking about those synergies. But we actively talk together and try to find ways in which the different domains can be bouncing off each other and contributing value to each other.
But in addition to that, you talked about a system of systems approach and other stakeholders being involved.
Yep.
That makes it a good deal more complex to understand, you know, how to predict what's actually going to happen. Right?
So that could open up a very, very long conversation on complex systems and complex science, which I would love to have. I firmly believe that aerospace at large is a complex system. I would encourage anybody in the audience to have a look at what the Santa Fe Institute does in that area. Yeah. It's just amazing stuff. And what we do in our sector is a it is a representative complex system where different agents in the system interact. It's a complex network. You cannot predict the emergent properties of that sector unless you understand the each individual stakeholder and node and the way that they all interact together. And it's a very, well, it's a complex situation. So yes, it is hard to predict. It's up to us though to at least try to understand the connections and to build the connections and to, as a starting point, to try to build awareness in the minds of each person in their organisation, in their department at the university, in whatever field they're in, to be thinking in terms of that system and where they might find their place in it.
Okay. Yeah, we should have a further conversation. So let's talk more specifically about the domain for aeronautics. So what are the headline strategic themes you see for AIAA in the sector more broadly as it pertains to the domain for aeronautics?
Let me list a few, but then I want to map something out for you. At the moment, the Domain for Aeronautics has four task forces that report to me, and I inherited them when I started in this role at the end of last year. They were set up by my predecessor, Ming, who unfortunately passed away last year. Sustainability and decarbonisation. Well, let's just call it sustainable aviation is one of them. Advanced air mobility is another one. Certification, the way that we certify and regulate, particularly advanced air mobility systems. These are three very, very core pressing issues for the aerospace sector at the moment and for aviation in particular, and also high-speed flight. So there's these four areas. I actually see them in different ways. And I see sustainability as something that's quite different to the other three. Sustainability gets at the why question. And I'd like to propose to you all today that this is something that we all need to be considering. What is the why? Why do we do what we do in the aerospace sector? It's not aerospace for the sake of aerospace. It's aerospace to meet global needs, to meet societal, socioeconomic needs, national security needs. Those global challenges, sustainability is one of them. And so the topic of sustainability is something that we actually need to be weaving into the very DNA, the fabric of everything that we do in this community. And that's a challenge. That's a challenge that I grapple with constantly. So I put that in a category of its own. Then there are what I'll call transformational themes for the aviation sector or for the aerospace sector. And I would say advanced air mobility is a transformational theme. And high-speed flight is a transformational theme. And they can have a sustainability aspect to them. But they're more focused on the actual aviation technologies themselves. And then when it comes to certification, I see that as an enabling or facilitating theme. So it's a little bit different again. So we've got those four themes. There are other opportunities on the horizon. Horizon is a very, very important word. It's something that we all need to be doing, that is scanning the horizon, looking for what's coming from within our sector and over the fence from other sectors. And one of those, as we all know, is artificial intelligence. The whole world changed back in November 2022 with generative AI and the uptake of ChatGPT. The whole world's going nuts. We are going to see an AI-enabled aviation sector. There's a lot of work going on within AIAA in the area of digital transformation and artificial intelligence, and a lot of work from the bottom up in the research and development domain. And so Greg Zacharias is looking at that, and many of the TCs, technical committees, are looking at that. But there's also a top-down piece of thinking that's needed. What will it mean for AI to be woven through the decision-making processes, the certification processes, the operational processes, not just AI in the widget? And so there's a coming together of those domain approaches needed there as well.
Right.
And there are other themes that are going to be rearing up as time goes on. For example, what does it mean to bring quantum technologies into the aviation sector?
Mm-hmm.
I believe we'll see that. And it's not a matter of if, but when. And I think when is closer than we might think. Yeah, so these are the themes that I'm grappling with and thinking about in the domain for aeronautics.
So you talked about these themes and transformation, disruption ahead. Any thoughts on parallels for the space sector?
If you think about what took place, think about the space sector until about 10 to 15 years ago. Let's say 15 years ago. What was the space sector? There were a small number of players. It was the domain for state actors and very, very large companies, aerospace primes. And a typical space asset was very large and very expensive, and there was a very, very low tolerance for risk. So then a funny thing happened, and it's a classic example of Clayton Christensen's disruptive technology, disruptive innovation process. Clayton Christensen, the late professor from Harvard Business School. Along came CubeSats. CubeSats, back in the day, small educational toy, couldn't possibly disrupt a sector. Or could they? It turns out that they have.
Mm-hmm.
Because if you take the incremental progression from individual small CubeSats, combine that with reduced cost of access to launch, and now you have constellations of hundreds and thousands of small spacecraft, miniaturized spacecraft,
mm-hmm.
microsats and smaller. You have many, many commercial players. I have a slide that I show at the INSEAD Business School. Back in 2011, there was one commercial organization trying to put constellations of small spacecraft in orbit, and that was Planet.
Yeah.
10 years later, in 2021, there was 250 organizations trying to do the same thing.
Yeah.
So it's a disruptive approach. The barriers to entry have reduced. These constellations aren't just hub and spoke with lots of individual spacecraft at the end of spokes to a central hub. They're starting to be coordinated. They're starting to become an entity of their own, a complex system. So that's what when I think about space and the parallels with where aeronautics and aviation might be going, I think of that.
Mm-hmm.
So what does that mean for aviation? Okay, so we have drones. Small, cute toys, right? Maybe not. Yeah. And we could have the same conversation about how drones have been evolving and where that might be going to the point where now we have many newcomers on the scene from a commercial perspective. They're designing and developing electric vertical takeoff and land, cargo and passenger aircraft.
Mm.
Case in point, I was in a conversation with one such organisation very recently who have a footprint in Australia. They see two immediate business cases in Australia, and I find this quite fascinating. If anybody's familiar with Sydney, we have the main airport in Botany Bay, not very far from the CBD, building a new airport out in the western part of Sydney. The cost of a taxi is to get from the CBD out to where the new airport will be, let's say $150, $200. It's quite a long way, and you'll spend an hour and a half in traffic. Well, one of these drones could take four passengers from the CBD to the new airport in 14 minutes for about the same cost per person. That's one possible business case that company is looking at. Another business case is ecotourism up on the Great Barrier Reef. At the moment, international tourists come to Australia and they spend a staggering amount of money on helicopter joy flights over the Barrier Reef. You could replace that with these same vehicles. So we're seeing this disruption, this slow process of disruption taking place. And if you stick around for the Forum 360 that will be from 9:30 till 11:30 this morning, we'll be teasing some of that out in the context of an interesting scenario.
That sounds really interesting. I have been stuck in Sydney traffic going to the airport, so I do understand what that means, right? We've talked about strategic issues from a technology perspective. Let's broaden the discussion. There must be some non-technical issues we need to keep in our sight, big issues like workforce and leadership. Can you give your thoughts on those?
Workforce and leadership, they're both very, very dear to my heart. On the workforce side, one of the things that we're seeing happening in the sector that we are in, but the, every sector, is the change, the generational changes in the workforce. Mm-hmm. We now have the situation, there are, I think there's five, officially five or maybe it's six, it might be five generations in the workforce at the same time. From baby boomers, there's still a few of the, I'm not sure what we call the pre-baby boomers, but let's say baby boomers all the way down to Gen Z, all in the workforce at the same time. That actually has an impact on business. It has an impact on the way organisations work. It has an impact on the culture within them. Mm-hmm. And that's something that we in the aerospace sector need to be mindful of. And we need to be aware that the young people today, they're born digital native. Mm-hmm. And I would say that they are already AI savvy. It's just natural. And they're born into a world that is extremely complex, far more complex than the world that I was born into. Mm-hmm. And somehow they can navigate that. It's okay to not know everything. It's okay to be uncertain about many things and to somehow be able to take decisions and navigate through that world. They think differently to the way I do, the way many of us in this sector do. And that's a serious challenge for many of the organisations in the aerospace sector, I believe, to account for that, because those people are the current and incoming workforce. And how do we embrace those capabilities? How do we deal with the way that they think? It's a serious thing.
Right.
And how do we educate them? I listen to a lot of podcasts. One of the podcasts I listen to, interesting pair of guys that many of you will be aware of, Mark Andreessen and Ben Horowitz. They have the investment firm in Silicon Valley, A16Z, and they have a podcast, or that organisation has a podcast. And every now and again, Mark and Ben get on this podcast, and they just bounce off each other talking about ideas. Well, so I was on my farm at home with my whippersnipper, whippersnipping lots of grass and listening for about 2 hours to Mark Andreessen and Ben Horowitz dissecting the North American tertiary education sector. Turns out that Ben is he's on the Board of Trustees of Columbia University. And that was one of the most fascinating conversations I've ever listened to. And they drew the conclusion at the end that the education sector in North America, and it's the same in Australia and the UK and Europe and so on, it's ripe for, it's ready for disruption. It's ready for newcomers to come in and deliver education in ways that completely disrupt the business models mm-hmm. of the typical universities that we have and the way that the education is delivered. I think that that's true. I've been part of the university sector for many years. I'm still associated with universities, and I see that there are ways that we can use generative AI. There are ways that we can engage with the way that good education is not teacher focused.
Right.
Yes. As you know, it's not about the professor standing in front of the class, dumping information at them.
Right.
It's about providing the learning environment for the learner. And the way the young people are wanting to learn and engage today is just given who they are and the changing generations. They're different to the way they used to be. So I believe that there is going to be disruption. I don't know what that looks like yet, but it's going to be disruption in the education sector, and I think that AIAA can play a major role in working with the educational institutions in understanding what that could be and supporting them and plugging into it. So that was workforce, and you mentioned leadership as well.
Yeah.
So as Dan Dumbacker mentioned, I helped teach into the INSEAD Business School's advanced management program in their strategic thinking. INSEAD described three altitudes of leadership. They describe, and actually you'll notice the session today, we've called it the view from 50,000 feet. The 50,000 foot level is the strategic visionary level. Leaders have to be good at that. And it's so important these days to get better and better at that, because all sectors are being disrupted, and there's waves of disruption that they just keep coming, and they're coming faster and they're stronger and from unexpected directions. And so leaders have to be able to do the horizon scanning and asking what if questions and asking what's new type questions. Mm-hmm. There's a very good example of that in the aerospace sector, actually. Jack Welch, when he was CEO at GE, comes into work one day, gets in the lift to go up to the floor wherever his office suite is. And there's a gentleman in the lift with him who has come for a meeting for some other purpose, and that gentleman's name was Ram Charan. And Ram looks at him and says, has no idea who Jack Welch is, and says, "What's new?" And Jack looks at him and is like, what do you mean? What's new? What's new in your world? I want to know. Later that day, Jack gets to thinking, and he ends up getting in contact with Ram Charan, flies him to his personal private home somewhere in wherever he lives, spends the weekend with him, quizzing him, what do you mean by what's new? Ram Charan ends up becoming Jack's personal coach for many years, helping Jack ask that question, what's new? What's going on in that sector? What's going on in this sector? What new technology is being developed? What new business model is being developed? So that 50,000 feet is very, very important. But the other two altitudes, there's the 50-foot level. That's tactical, operational. Leaders have to be able to execute. As scientists and engineers and technical-type managers in this room, all of us together, we're pretty good at tactical and operational. Mm-hmm. So let's skip over that. The other altitude, the very, very important one, is the 5-foot level. And that's the personal level. That's the level where the leader is aware of themselves, of their own drivers and blockers, aware of their team, aware of human dynamics, aware of communication styles and personality styles, and aware of the fact that the leader is on show. The leader starts with the culture. The leader sets the culture and has to walk the talk and demonstrate that to their team. In this disruptive world that we're in, being able to do that, it's going to become increasingly more important. It's always been important, but it's going to get more and more important. Can I give you an example of how I saw that play out in my own team, in the space team? So over the last 10 years in Canberra, we built this space mission team. There was nothing happening in space at the time in Australia, so we were breaking new ground. Main stakeholder was defence. Defence took a gamble on us, wanted an Australian organisation to demonstrate that Australian homegrown technology could be flown and operate in orbit. And so we built this team up to about 60 people, and we were on the hook for delivering a bunch of satellite missions for the Royal Australian Air Force, as a precursor to Defence Space Command being set up. And there was a lot at stake. The money from that flow was starting to run out. The intelligence community was stepping in and saying, well, we like what's going on, we'd like some more of that. And then that possible contract, it vaporised overnight at the end of 2019. Mm-hmm. And the university said, well, we can't keep paying the salary bills of all of those people. You've got to find more money or you have to sack them. And then COVID hit. And over a period of several months, I didn't have to sack as many people as I thought I had, but I still had to get rid of 25% of the team, and COVID hit, and they were on the hook for delivering these satellites. And these satellites weren't just CubeSats. They were, so this was the M2 mission. Imagine a 12U thing that could split, fractionate into two 6U halves. Each half had four optical imaging capabilities and software-defined radio capabilities that could sense all sorts of things, as well as onboard artificial intelligence, as well as science experiments for interacting with the ionosphere and so on. So it was very, very complicated. Wind forward to March of 2021, the team had been in lockdown. In fact, they had built, designed and built and tested these satellites through lockdown. We were launching on Rocket Lab out of New Zealand. And so the process was we had to send the spacecraft to New Zealand, and we had to send a couple of our team to New Zealand to receive the spacecraft, but everything was in lockdown, so they had to go to New Zealand, go into quarantine for a couple of weeks, having just finished an exhausting process of test and evaluation. And they get into the Rocket Lab clean room, they receive the spacecraft, and they have to do some functional checks. It was an unfamiliar environment with unfamiliar tools, and turned out to plug in the harnesses for the communication and power into these spacecraft. They had to kind of tilt their head the wrong way, and they were disoriented, and they plugged comms into power and power into comms for one of the spacecraft and fried it, like killed it. So this wasn't dead on arrival, this was dead before arrival. Now these two spacecraft were connected to each other. New Zealand government steps in, and the FAA is kind of standing in the background waving, saying, hello, what's going on? And we had a choice. We had like 3 or 4 days to officially hand this over, these spacecraft over to Rocket Lab. And New Zealand government says, if you launch, you can't separate them from each other to fulfill your mission, because that would be deliberately deploying space junk. It's clear that you have a piece of space junk.
It's dead, yeah, right.
If we launched and if we did not separate them, mission was dead.
Yeah.
Either way, it looked like mission was dead. That was a project killer. That was a team killer. That meant that a very large number of very tired and quite stressed people were going to be looking for new jobs during COVID. So you can imagine the stress that that put these two guys who were there at the launch site. This is where the team culture kicked in. And this is the message that I want to get across. If you get the culture right, it's just so important and so powerful. So we rallied around these two guys from a distance. No blame, let's solve this, let's take this as a team, and let's figure out what to do. So the Sparkies, the electrical engineers, they went into the clean room, they got the same equipment, and they deliberately fried it the same way. And then they started tinkering.
All right.
And they figured out how to, with the right amount of current, for the right amount of time, how to gently ablate the carbon and defry the electronics. And then they put together a process that it was effectively a telemedicine remote operation. The two guys in New Zealand, neither of whom were electrical engineers, one was mechanical, one was software, were suited up, gowned, hooded, the whole works, like not scalpel in hand, but soldering iron, wire cutters, etc. And a 36-hour Teams call took place. Snip here, solder there, power here, do this, do that. And layer by layer, they were able to work their way down into the spacecraft and unfry 90% of it, and it was game on. And they could only do that because the team culture was able to pull that off. The times ahead are going to be disruptive, and so building that culture and having the awareness as leaders of the imperative to do that, and being there with the team and demonstrating the values and the culture, that's my biggest, strongest message.
Okay. So I think we've got time for one or two questions. So if you'd like to ask Russ a question, there should be a link there. or go to the speaker Q&A tab on the virtual platform to submit a question. And by the magic of the internet, it should appear up here on this iPad. So, I don't see any questions. And we'd like to submit a question.
Here we are.
Yep, got it. Oh, by the magic of the internet, it was hiding them from me. here's the top question. Hypersonics is becoming the technology of the age. What are your thoughts about hypersonics moving to commercial travel?
So hypersonics for commercial travel. There are some, okay, there's some advantages, there's some gotchas. Are we going to see commercial hypersonic vehicles for passenger transport? Let's hope so. There's a lot of work being done in the hypersonics community, and there are people in the room and people here at this event this week working very hard on that, the High Speed Flight Task Force representing that community. But some of the things that they are wrangling with, there are issues like emissions. As somebody, I heard somebody put it, with no disrespect intended to Taylor Swift, is Taylor Swift and people like her going to be the only people who would be able to afford their own hypersonic business jet? And in the process, would they be screwing up the atmosphere with the emissions trails? So these are issues that, this doesn't mean that we can't solve them. I think the jury's out on this. This is something that we need to be working on, and hopefully we will solve that. But the environmental impact is an issue. The business case is an issue. And we're also going to have to be very sensitive of national security. Mm. A high-speed thing is a high-speed thing. If you take the people out of it, you have a weapon. And so it's not an insurmountable challenge, but it is a challenge to be able to build a hypersonic commercial system that it cannot easily be turned into a hypersonic weapon system if the wrong people got, were able to hack into it, for example. And I will say one other thing. I spent 25 years doing hypersonics. I know how quickly a scramjet engine can turn into a ramjet engine. It takes milliseconds, and the process involved destroys the engine, and the drag goes through the roof, and the propulsion efficiency goes through the floor. And if there's anybody on board a scramjet-powered vehicle that gets the inlet processes wrong or the combustion processes wrong, then that's going to be a difficult day at the office for them.
Yeah.
So human rating such a system is a challenge. But a hypersonic commercial vehicle doesn't necessarily need to be an air breather.
Right. Now the most popular question. What are your thoughts on space debris due to CubeSats and other large satellite networks?
A very large part of the research that my team were doing in the space program that we developed was space domain awareness, space situational awareness. Space debris was a big deal for us. We were very conscious of the fact that we were building CubeSats and putting them into orbit. Were we contributing to space debris? Well, we weren't putting them up so high that they would stay there for a very long time. So we were in that self-cleaning part of the low Earth orbit atmosphere. But space debris is a big challenge. The need for tracking, the need for systems that can autonomously avoid space debris is important. And I saw that firsthand. We would get notification at least once a week that a Starlink satellite had to autonomously avoid our CubeSats.
Oh.
And I've just had a mental blank. There was something that I was going to say in response. Maybe it'll come back.
Well, I'll ask you the next question. So this should be the final question, I think. What can older generations learn from Gen Z in the workplace?
Gen Z, or Gen Z as good English speakers would say. in the workplace, these young people, as I said earlier, they think differently. They're not afraid to ask questions. They're not afraid to try new things. They're not afraid to jump very quickly from one employer to another. They're not afraid to use digital tools and to do them very, very rapidly. They're examples of things that the older generation can learn from them. I think for the older generation, it's... Let's say that I'm part of the older generation. The speed with which I can use my fingers and thumbs on a keyboard in my hand to send a message is, it's like a turtle compared to a hypersonic vehicle. And the Gen Zers, they're the hypersonic vehicle when it comes to communication and doing things short and sharp. I don't think the older generation needs to become like that. I don't think we necessarily can. I don't think I could. But we need to be aware that that is the way that they communicate. That's the way that they think. Mm-hmm. So I think it's more of an awareness. There's different styles of approach to work, of approach to communication, of approach to thinking and outlook. And lastly, we also need to be cognizant of the fact that the younger generations deeply care about the planet. Mm. I think it's no longer the case that we can simply say space, for example, is inspiring, or high-speed aircraft are inspiring, and surely the kids are going to get inspired and go and do STEM. I don't think that sort of thing cuts it anymore. I think for the young person, it's how can we use those amazing technologies to execute change for good on this planet, to fix some of the problems that we have. Mm. They care deeply about that, and they have a voice, and they want it heard. And the older generation, we need to be listening for that voice and allowing it to be heard.
Yeah, I've definitely seen that in the students that I talk to. You know, the concern about sustainability and the environment is much higher than it used to be. So perhaps we're moving away from higher, faster, further to also continuing to do that. I mean, in some sense, that's what hypersonics is, as well as caring deeply about the effects on the environment and what we can do to sustain it, right?
And I think this plays back into the why. Why do we do what we do? Well, we can build new aerospace systems, whether they be for air or for space, in order to be able to be part of the solution for these mega challenges that our planet has.
Yes. Okay, I think we're going to have to wrap it up, I think, now. So I've thank you very much for your insightful comments. So I have a number of post-plenary announcements. So thank you to the audience for your participation and your questions. So coming up next on the stage here, several industry leaders will continue the view from 50,000 feet during the first Forum 360 session this morning. This is after the coffee break. They will share their perspectives on the health of the industry, highlight the successes from the past year, and outline the challenges we're facing. So for all of you, you have a lot of choices about where to invest your time today in sessions at technical paper presentations. We're continuing a recent addition to the program called Flight Lab Sessions. These are special sessions that were proposed with a call for content. You'll find them all in Alliance Ballroom 321. Check out those topics. At 3 p.m., students and young professionals can network and kickstart their careers at a Meet the Employers session. The room is now Forum Ballroom 117. And at 6 p.m., you're invited to the EATS Social Hour. Join the EATS conference for an evening exploring electrification. It's a perfect opportunity to network, share insights, and get the week off to a great start. So with that, let's thank Russ for his...
And thank you to Dan.